a scholar, and I also had the privilege of going through his dissertation on Nakashi scrolls, which is an excellent piece of work, academic work. So Lakshman recently had an exhibition in Kolkata, and he has been much admired, and he's got, I think, a whole troop of followers now who have fallen in love with his paintings, the rural landscape of Telangana mainly. About Naranaswamy Venkata Yogi, he's got a master's degree in engineering before moving to US as an IT professional, but he's also a poet, and he has 3 volumes of poetry so far, Kalola, Kalala, Megham, which won him the Free Verse Front Award in 1994. And I guess he's going to read from Vanustada today, is it? Vanustada. So over to both of you for your wonderful presentation, joint presentation.
Good evening, everyone. I really appreciate this wonderful opportunity here to be with all of you. As Professor has said, I live in the United States, but I'm a native of Telangana, a place called Siddipet, and I've been writing poetry since quite some time. And this Vanustada is my 3rd volume, for which Dr. Lakshman Yele has rendered his drawings. And what I want to do today is wanted to read a few poems, if I get an opportunity. But initially, I would like to start with the title poem. And this one, I'll first read it in English, and then read it in Telugu, so that we all have a comprehensive understanding of what's going on. Other way? Okay. Okay, then that'll be fine. Yeah, a little bit of background about this poem. I had written this poem during the Telangana movement in support of it. And basically, the poem itself indicates the welcoming of Telangana, or the aspiration for a Telangana state. And now we are in the Telangana state. Vanustada. Iparanna vastadantava. Iparanna vastadantava. Mogulumida. ఎండిపోయిన బట్టపేల్కల్ లెక్క మబ్బులు ఎన్నొద్దుల ఎదిరిసూపు వచ్చినట్టే వచ్చి మత్పరిస్తుంది ఏన్ల సంధి చేస్తున్నాం ఏన్ల సంధి చేస్తున్నాం ఒక్కటవుడు కండ్లల్లో ఒత్తులేసుకునుడు కలిసి ధూల ఆడుడు ఆసన్నా ఊసన్నా అనుకుంటూ బతుకు పీరీలు ఎత్తుకునుడు కలల్ని బతుకమ్మలు చేసి పాడుకునుడు ఎన్నొద్దుల నుంచి చేస్తున్నాం ఓర్చుకోలేని కష్టం వస్తే గుప్పలవుతున్నాం మల్ల మల్ల తనులాడుతున్నాం ఏన్ల సంధి చేస్తనే ఉన్నాం నీటి సుక్కలేని ఉరుముల్నే వింటున్నాం మన ఈపుల మీదికెళ్ళి ఈ బండలు పోతాయా మన ఈపుల మీదికెళ్ళి ఈ బండలు పోతాయా ఆశలింకని మన కండ్లు పిల్లలాడుకునే గోటీలు ఆశలింకని మన కండ్లు పిల్లలాడుకునే గోటీలు ఈపారి మనమే మొగులైనం ఈపారి మనమే మొగులైనం సిగమొచ్చి మబ్బుల నెత్తి ఇరబోసుకున్నాం సిగమొచ్చి మబ్బుల నెత్తి విరబోసుకున్నాం ఉబ్బసమంత పోయేటట్టు ఉరుముతున్నాం కసితో పెయ్యంత రిక్కించి మెరుస్తున్నాం ఇక కుండపోతగా కురుస్తాం ఇక కుండపోతగా కురుస్తాం మన ధూప తీర్చుకునేటందుకు మనమే జడివానవుతాం మన ధూప తీర్చుకునేటందుకు మనమే జడివానవుతాం దట్స్ ద పోయమ్ లెట్ మీ రీడ్ ద ట్రాన్స్లేషన్ విల్ ఇట్ రెయిన్ డూ యూ థింక్ ఇట్ విల్ రెయిన్ ఎట్లీస్ట్ దిస్ టైమ్ ఆన్ ద క్లోత్ లైన్ ఆఫ్ ద స్కై క్లౌడ్లెట్స్ లుక్ లైక్ ష్రివల్డ్ డ్రైడ్ అప్ ర్యాగ్స్ How long have we been waiting? Raising hopes by their appearance, they disappear in no time. For ages, we have been watching. They overwhelm the sky. With the smell of the rain and the wind, we eagerly look. Together, we play dhula with soil, holding our breath. We carry the peers of life and sing minstrels, making batukamma of our dreams. When an insufferable grief befalls bully ourselves to silence, and we restart the long haul once again. Have been watching for years, listening to the dry thunders of rainless clouds. We have been watching for years, listening to the dry thunders of the rainless clouds. Do you think we can get rid of these boulders from our necks? Do you think we can get rid of these boulders from our backs? Our inveterate hopeful eyes are but marbles for our children to play. Our inveterate hopeful eyes are but marbles for our children to play. This time, we ourselves become clouds. This time, we ourselves become clouds. Like the possessed, we grab the clouds and spread wide, thundering till we are cured of our breathlessness. Our bodies tremble with ages of revengeful spite. Now we are going to rain cats and dogs. Now we are going to rain cats and dogs to quench our very own thirst. This was translated by Nauduri Murthy. He is a good translator. He has translated a few of my poems. And he also sent it to me for a review because he was not very familiar with Telangana language. And there are some words like peyi. Peyi means a calf in Andhra, whereas peyi means body in Telugu, in Telangana. So, matparistadi is another word. So there are some typical Telangana native words that I try to use in the poetry.
Yeah. Wonderful, wonderful presentation and Lakshman painting. So this is how you have the intersemiotic translation wonderfully going on. And this was something that we had dreamt and we could actually do it, thanks to both of you, that we could really materialize this. Do you have another poem?
Yeah, I do. Do I get a chance or?
In 5 minutes, is that possible?
Sure.
Lakshman, you want to paint something else?
No. I don't have
okay. We move over to Sarbjit Gorcha next. He's a bilingual poet, an editor, translator, and publisher. So, Sarbjit, yes. He's based in Delhi.
Yeah. Thank you, Joyta. Good evening, friends. I'll begin with a bhakti poet you all know, and maybe like me, you must be fond of. But you see, reading this bhakti poet again and again, I've always felt that he wanted me to be free of him. So this is a poem titled Unlearning Kabir. It's from my latest book, A Clock in the Far Past. Rochelle and I have been reading our works in various cities. So, okay, over to Unlearning Kabir. The unseen singer living in the heart sings. Keep listening to the song. Keep crushing grass, no matter what riverbank you are at. There's no room for anything in the song but doom. The loom is lucid in its rattle. Just hold on to the chosen thread to reach the source of the throb that has robbed you of peace. This poet weaver, perhaps armchair potter too, will never become obsolete. A clod of earth in his fingers will always be an entrancing weapon, threatening to mash the mundane with a decisiveness impossible to undo. Aiming for your heart, he will hurl the maxim-hewn mud ball at you as your outstretched arm flashes a denying palm. Less of a shield, more of a shatterer that multiplies the airborne blob into a quick spatter of muck beads adorning the face. Then it is up to you. See if sifting through the glossary of burial rites you're ready to be wooed into giving up your accrued sum of infinitesimals this easily. It is not just the grit in the words that'll get you, but also the voice they wear. Mud is the only music spread in the corpus of the weaver's poetry, each word reminding of the mortal remains being daubed into dirt even before the eyes can let out their final squirt to wash down what you took for mere muck marks. Let the mudlark hiding in the heart continue to turn the sill that once was one with the voice of the river, till your fingers glow with permanent grains promising the harvest of private wisdom. Let closed eyes read what you've never written, but what you know is always lurking in the dark interior. It is then that the ear will get accustomed to the repetitive counsel, make mud, make it mud, make it one with mud. Since this is a conference devoted to texts, I'll read a poem on the religious text of the Sikhs. The Sikhs consider the Guru Granth Sahib as their last guru, as it was proclaimed by the 10th Guru, Guru Gobind Singh. You'll come across two words here. One is Granthi. Granthi is the reader of the scripture, the reader of the Granth, the priest who reads it every day. And the number 6 here refers to the 6 gurus who contributed to the Granth Sahib. We had 10 gurus, but only 6 contributed to the book, the sacred book. Keeper of the Granth. The Granthi sobs over the beauty of the lines. Their hold on him has been extreme. He doesn't regret not having written them himself. His fingers wear the snow the 6 mountains melded into the book had shed on the thatch of his hut, huddled in silence when a newly come summer shone in its floodlight with such zeal that his nights forgot to dim themselves to a soporific black. He woke to the tingle of mysterious voices whispering into his ears. Poise came to him wearing the ankle bells of song, and he became a musical instrument strummed by the invisible fingers of the one who had invented the script called Gurmukhi. What is it to me? He says to anyone who cares to know. Look at the horizon.
International University in Miami. Congratulations for that. And his book of poems is named Find Me Leonard Cohen, and I'm almost 30. So we have one of the fans of Leonard Cohen over here. So I don't know whether you're going to read from this.
Yeah.
Over to you.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. This is my recently published collection, Find Me Leonard Cohen, I'm Almost 30. It's a curious title. It's dedicated to the great Leonard Cohen, who was a novelist turned poet turned singer turned pop star turned, so he was called the Angel of Doom in the 1970s. People committed suicide reading, listening to his music. So is it's alleged, but he was a fantastic man. He passed over 2 years ago. But the title is this because he himself wrote this as a graffiti on a Montreal wall in the 1960s for a girl called Marita. So he wrote, "Find me Marita, I'm almost 30. And he couldn't find Marita. He went on to write a beautiful song about her also. So I'll be reading a couple of poems from here. This one is called Vatiba. Vatiba was a woman who was found inside the body of a reticulated python with her dress intact. She looked alive, but she was dead. She was swollen by the python. It's about her. Vatiba is 54. Vatiba is afraid only of wild boar. Vatiba is lying on the floor. They are saying Vatiba is no more. Her eyes are shut, but she looks the same. They say she's suddenly got international fame. Field, forest, predators, and preys. Vatiba knows her prayers, and ways. The boar is off to sleep, she said, and went into the night. In the morning, they found her slippers and torch light. They could not find blood. They could not find torn dress. Like the missing Malaysian airplane, this was also darkness. Until they saw a reticulated python doing a happy hiss, bloated, gloating, unable to move, impossible to miss. They cut him open, and there was Vatiba, intact in her dress. Vatiba, weary of life, had found a new address. An old man said, "Trust me, she looks the same, and also her dress. She's dead. That's a shame." A young girl joined in. "Did another python swallow the plane, and they have been looking in vain? The missing student of an Indian university, the girls missing from many a city, the missing Jaffna civilians, the missing heroes of war, missing births, missing deaths, missing files, missing scar. They have burst crackers at the return of the missing god. You can't even see the sky. It's a missing pole star. But when you find them, they look all the same. Pity they're dead. That's a shame. What are we missing? How big is this python? What is his name? Is it Sheshnag? No, 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 no. That's the Lord Snake. It's the python to blame. Is this python a pied piper luring us all? Does the python thunder? It thundered the night Vatiba vanished. This python swallowing the world, how big is it, I wonder? Vatiba is lying on the floor. They're saying Vatiba is no more. Her eyes are shut, but she looks the same. And her dress, she's dead. That's a shame.
Thank the organizers for inviting me for this paper. Sridhar said 8 minutes, right? So I'll plunge into the paper right away. My paper is divided into two parts. I focused mainly on academic textbook translations in the first part. And in the second part, it maps the literary translation, focusing only on poetry. Because it was not possible, in fact, to do all the genres of Urdu literature. So I just focused on these two. Translations of academic textbooks. A little socio-political and cultural background to understand the interaction between Urdu and English languages. I think I'll skip some of this, and if there is time, I'll come back again. Mapping the field of Urdu-English interface in Telangana. To map the field of Urdu and English interface in Telangana, we need to trace our steps back to 1790s and look at the social structure of Nizam's Hyderabad. The use of English was closely linked to the social status of a person in the Jagirdari families. Many in this class increased their contacts with English in the hope of getting a secure position. They adapted English language and culture for their political survival. Social structure of the Nizam. At that time, Persian was the state language. Urdu was used at the informal level. The 19th century saw the decline of the Mughals. The Hyderabad state continued with Persian-Urdu dualism. English also made its entry at a multilingual atmosphere, increased the vistas of knowledge. Language policy of the British. The British did not have a consensus on English as an official language. One section among them felt that India should remain attached to Arabic, Persian, and Sanskrit. A second group wanted Urdu as an official language. A third group wanted to withdraw all patronage to Indian languages and implement English as the official language in all sections of administration. Madrasas in Hyderabad. During the Bahmani Sultanate, that is from 1347 to 1518, important madrasas in Hyderabad were Madarsa-e Shuja, Madarsa-e Maulvi Nurullah, Madarsa-e Khate Alam, and Madarsa-e Makkah Masjid. The nature of education was religious, instruction was in Persian and Arabic, explanations were in Urdu. In mid-19th century, the state adapted the English education policy of the British, in which education of the common citizen was not the responsibility of the state. I think we are reaching that now. First English-Urdu interface. 1791, Fakhruddin Ali Khan was admitted into Nawab Nizam Ali Khan's palace for higher education. For his knowledge, intellect, and his efforts to raise the standard of higher education, Fakhruddin Ali Khan was given the title Shamsul Umra. He was well versed in Arabic, Persian, Urdu, French, and English languages. He was also interested in science and mathematics, astronomy, chemistry, philosophy, geography, and other subjects. Got many books translated into Urdu from French and English. Here we find that during the first phase of translation, it was the personal effort of certain people that had given impetus to the translation. Center for Translation. Shamsul Umrah created an atmosphere of learning science through the medium of Urdu. Shamsul Umrah selected books in all the subjects from French and English and got them translated into Urdu by renowned scholars under his guidance. The translations were of three types: free translations, the gist of the original book, summaries of several translations. Several scientific books were translated and printed in the litho press of Shamsul Umrah. Some manuscript of these books can be found in the Idara-e-Adabiyat-e-Urdu in Panjagutta in Hyderabad. After the death of Shamsul Umrah, 1862, the translation work slowed down. Some medical books in Shamsul Umrah's school were translated by Dr. McLean and Dr. McKenzie, who were the surgeons at Medical College, Hyderabad Medical School. In 1846, an allopathic medical college was established in Hyderabad. The medium of instruction was Urdu. This facilitated the translation of many medical books from English to Urdu. Rise of English as a medium of instruction. In 1825, St. George's Church in Secunderabad started an English medium school. It was shifted to Chandraghat in 1846 as Protestant school. Later it came to be known as St. George's Grammar School. Darul Uloom started in 1857, became Oriental College under the affiliation of Punjab University with 130 students and 113 teachers. Look at the ratio of the student teacher here. A petition was given for a Deccan University about the same time, but no progress showed in this direction. Persian and Arabic were fighting a losing battle for existence. Urdu fared well, and English was becoming important. The beginnings of the 20th century. Things didn't change in the beginning of the 20th century. Language equations remained more or less the same, and English gained a pride of place. In 1904, the number of students studying in different languages in Hyderabad were as follows. Urdu, 27,357. Telugu, 11,779. Marathi, 18,104. Kannada, 4,337. And English, 8,746. Usmania University. The landmark in the starting the university was 1907. The decision of Punjab University to not allow the students of Hyderabad to take their exam. This was felt as quite humiliating, and the demand for their own university was revived. A committee was formed by the government, and Maulana Shibli was made the chairperson to formulate the syllabus. It took 2 years for the syllabus to be written, and it got ready in 1913. At this time, there were three types of schools in Hyderabad: English, Oriental, and Vernacular. Vernacular had Telugu, Marathi, and Kannada languages. In 1915, a sweeping change came over. All the Oriental schools were changed into vernacular Urdu medium schools. This had a far-reaching effect on Urdu language in the state. In 1914, a conference was held in Hyderabad, which propagated the use of mother tongue in education. It also recognized the importance of English language for higher education. Although Urdu was the language of expression, study of English was made compulsory. A lot of Urdu books were needed, hence the need for Center for Translation. Bureau of Translation. 13th of August 1917, an application was made for the Bureau of Translation. On 14th of August 1917, a GO was passed for the establishment of the Bureau. Mir Usman Ali Khan took special interest in the establishment of the university and gave financial and other support. Darut Tarjama, or the Bureau of Translation. This translated many technical, scientific, and other books with speed and alacrity. Thus, the Bureau of Translation played a vital role in the structure of Usmania University. The efforts started by Shamsul Umrah in translating scientific and technical books were revived. Great scholars were appointed from across the land. Translation Bureau was established on 16 September 1917 and Usmania University was established 2 years later, that is in 1919. New terms in Urdu. The Bureau had committed to coinage of new words in Urdu. It gives a list of new coinages in Urdu in different subjects by the end of 1947. Philosophy, 837 words. History, 618. Sociology, 1729. Education, 5779. Law, 18,000. Mathematics, 696. Chemistry, 1176. Physics, 1263. Geology, 1200. Biology, 7000. Medicine, 40,000. And engineering, 10,000. So this was one of the contributions to Urdu of translating the academic books. Thus, by 1947, a total of 88,889 words were coined in Urdu from English by the Bureau. By March 1946, according to one report, it had translated 500 books in Urdu. Usmania University was by now imparting not only technical and scientific, but also medical education in the medium of Urdu. The experiment of Usmania University proved successful, though Rabindranath Tagore was against calling it an experiment, but said it was a mission which was accomplished. This was the most successful period for English-Urdu interface. Unfortunately, the political atmosphere of the state changed and the sky was overcast. The decision to change the medium of education from Urdu to English was political and halted the work of translation. In 1949, the Vice Chancellor of Usmania University issued an order to the Bureau to stop the work of translation until further orders. On 8th August 1955, a fire broke out in Darut Tarjuma and all the books and manuscripts were turned to ashes. Part B, literary translations. That's only about poetry. One can speak of Urdu translation in poetry as having the following broad phases. The first one from the beginning, that is 1792 to 1914. Second, 1914 to 1947. And from 1947 to 1984. And after 1984. The translations of after 1904 are not included in this paper. From the beginning to 1914, the translation of an Urdu poem, Feel means elephant in Urdu. By a Persian, by a poet, Insha Allah Khan, Insha in 1792, is considered as the first poetic translation in Urdu. It describes the courting of Bahadur, a male elephant, of a mischievous and lovable female elephant. The English poem was written by John Clark. It was more or less a transcreation. In 1860, there was a spurt in the activity of translation from English into Urdu. This had positive impact on the style and ideas in Urdu poetry. There were efforts from both English scholars and Urdu poets to translate English poetry into Urdu. Noted among these were Altaf Hussain Hali, Muhammad Hussain Azad. These two poets took up translation to bring out a change in the style of Urdu poetry and succeeded to the great extent. The translations were generally of three types: literal translations, free translations, and translations which are based only on the idea. Azad and Hali did not know enough English, but they were constantly in touch with English professors and exchanged ideas with them. Some Urdu literary critics feel that their translations cannot be termed successful, but they were important in changing the trends in Urdu poetry. By the end of the 19th century, Urdu translations of English poetry was considered a serious activity. Allama Ali Haider Tabatabai was a great scholar of Persian, Arabic and Urdu. He was appointed to teach in some famous schools in Hyderabad. Later, he was made a professor at Nizam College in 1908. He translated grey stanzas written in a country churchyard as Gore Ghariba, which became a classic. Akbar Allahabadi translated Robert Sade's The Cataract of Lahore, which is also considered as a classic in Urdu literature. Literary journals of these times considered the translation of this period favorably. This created a demand for Urdu translations of English poetry. Munshi Artuza Ali Sharar, Abdul Halim Sharar, Munshi Vinayak Prasad Talib, Banarsi, Badruzama Badar, Ghumbik Narang, and Abdul Hamid Zameen Kanturi were all great poets of Urdu and great translators of poetry. Though all the above are not from Hyderabad, Dr. Sayyed Muhammad Allama Iqbal arrived in the beginning of 20th century. He gave the much needed impetus by translating Goethe, Hegel, Wordsworth and Tennyson and a few other well-known European writers. Impact of poetic translations. It would be worth considering the actual impact of these translations of poetry. Prior to these translations, Urdu poetry had long narrative poems, Qasida, Rubai, Qata, Masnavi and Ghazal.
Go into the 22 and even finer, you reach this pranic level. And then you can create sentiments through inner states of the consciousness. And when you stay at 12, then it becomes a music where you create patterns with the notes and then you express sentiment. You don't have this level of complexity, so you are free to explore speed, which the older system does not allow. So this is an example of how certain terms in a different context acquire new meanings and acquire and become associated with completely new practices, and a music becomes transformed in its very fundamental outlook, in its very philosophical basis. So that is the difference between this old tradition and the new tradition. And you have in India, because of the complexities of our country, you have several such traditions existing in parallel. More modern, old, even older, and this is a very interesting subject for somebody who is interested in music. The older system also has a lot of connotations for because the system uses a lot of things from phonetics, from pronunciation of vowels, consonants, because when you have these complexities of creating tonal imagery and at the same time dealing with a poetic text, and there are a lot of complexities that come in, but I cannot touch upon them, although I did that in my workshop and so on. So I'll conclude now, and thank you very much for, I hope it made some sense to you. And after this, if some of you are interested, I can show a little part of a long documentary film that I have made on my teacher. In this film, you will find some of these things in a very mixed way. It is not that you will be able to directly relate what I said to what you see in the film, but it is there at many levels. It is there mixed in a very complex narrative. And if you see the film, it might give you a kind of a feel for what I'm talking about. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. On behalf of Sezure Collective Society, Usmania University and Maulana Azad, I welcome Dr. M.A. Shakil, Registrar Maulana Azad National Urdu University, to the valedictory session of this three-day conference. This conference, True to Spirit, has helped to bridge both literary and linguistic boundaries nationally and internationally, and also helped to forge and establish bonds and friendship. I'm sure from this conference we have learned a lot about diverse canons and have been enriched with new insight for further research, which I'm sure is the purpose of any conference, and I think that is how the success of any conference can be measured. I once again welcome all of you and hope that we meet soon at other academic assemblies. Thank you, sir.
On behalf of the Center for Translation and Multilingualism, Usmania University and Sejure Collective Society, we welcome our Registrar of Maulana Azad National Urdu University, Dr. M.A. Sikandar Saab. I know that he's rushed for time, and we also apologize to Ashish Sankrityanji because we paused his valedictory address because you know, the registrar has some other engagement. So once the formal closure of the valedictory is over, by symbolically handing over a few certificates to some of the participants by the registrar, we will continue with Ashish Sankrityanji's. Thank you, sir, for taking your time out and being part of it. Let me quickly mention that we had 65 papers presented over 3 days, and we had both paper presenters from all over India, and we also had invited plenary speakers from abroad. And one of the things that came out again and again is how thankful we are on behalf of all the participants, how thankful we are to MANUU for hosting us, and you know, particularly the participants who stayed in the guest house were very happy with the way they were treated in the guest house and the wonderful volunteers we have had over the 3 days. I just wanted to say this to place it on record, sir. Thank you. Yeah, you can.
Thank you, sir. Actually, I want to be part of this. It's not like that I wanted to become as a chief guest or something. And once I was asked to be part of this valedictory program, I said yes, because people did not know I pursued English literature as a degree program, but I discontinued in American college. So I could not that become.
Right.
So I had to withdraw, and that was my first love, the language, English. But under the circumstances, I could not pursue. I had to get readmitted in history from the Madras University and pursue further higher education. So a lot of things came. So the first love become, you can't just forget it. In fact, I scored my, in the second education, I scored in the district second in one language. My parents did not know where those days are gone, where you are. So ultimately you have to, win a bread and butter. So you have to find a job. And when such a proposal came, I was, very eager to be part of with that. I'm pushing the department also, and my colleagues also, and many. I was just mentioning to you, this our is a national university. These resources are for belongs to nation, so it is not. It's to be shared with other institutions. So that is called university. We cannot work in isolation. I briefly met Professor Jeevan Devi in the lunch. So we were both in the members in the National Translation Mission, and we used to have a longer discussion in Mysore. And I wish all the best, and I don't want to keep you waiting. And I thank the CART, T&M, and CSR Collective Society, and thank the Adab Department, our all teacher colleagues and student to be attentive to this program, make it happen. And it make more inclusive for the university. It's not like Urdu means, it's not standalone Urdu. We are in a mainstream university. Somebody thinks it is only a language, but our focus is on language. At the same time, we are also a mandated for women education, technical education, and this is in one university. It runs from this, it runs schools, ITIs, polytechnics, and the postgraduate to research program also, and we have our presence in more than 15 states in dual mode, distance and all. I look for more such programs and collaborative program. That's it. Thank you very much. So if you permit, I will do. After that, I have to rest. I have to take one of an important person to meet somebody in the Rajendra Nagar in an institution. We have 5 o'clock. The meeting is scheduled. Otherwise, if you permit, I can go. Otherwise, sorry to.
Yeah.
Certificate, we may fill. Yeah. That is open. Thank you.
Divya?
Akanksha Visita.
There was no timely material assistance from the center. This conference would not have taken the shape that it did. EFL University, we are not actually, Dr. Tarakeshwar and I and many of the CIJURE participants here, the institution, we may not be representing the institution directly, but certainly we are here, as part of another important institution in Hyderabad. So if these three institutions did not come together in this fashion, a conference of this magnitude could not have been possible. We could not have envisaged something like this with just one or two sets of organizations coming together. Of course, this was a CIJURE conference. All of us here now are members of CIJURE, so I would like to begin by thanking all the members of CIJURE, old and new, for coming for the conference and for being a part of this three-day journey with us. We hope to renew our association, academic, cultural, in the coming years. First of all, there are many people and many parts to this conference which I have to acknowledge, and I have to thank each one of them, some by name, some by post, which I will go on to do. Professor Hasibuddin Kadri and all the faculty members of the Department of English, a big thank you to all of you. While we were still looking around for institutions to collaborate with, Professor Vijay Kumar here got in touch with the Department of English and got a very ready positive signal, and that was how this conference materialized. So thank you very much, the Department of English and the faculty members, the students, the MA students, the research scholars, the volunteers, who have worked for this conference. So a big thank you to all of you. Every institution we know needs to be supported by the authorities. The Vice Chancellor and the Pro Vice Chancellor of MANUU, whom we met, were very welcoming, were very warm, and promised us all the support the registrar who was here with us. We thank the authorities of MANUU for providing us through the Department of English all this assistance to help us put together this conference. The director of IMC, where the film screenings happened in their preview theater, and also the filming, the webcasting of many of the sessions of the conference was possible through IMC. The guest house, which was acknowledged some time ago, has taken care of all our outstation participants and some of us in-station participants as well, very wonderfully. So I thank the guest house staff. The faculty from other departments of MANUU, Translation Studies, Urdu, and other departments for chairing. The principal of the Polytechnic College, who immediately responded to many of our requests, who also provided this space for this conference to be able to go on in this way in multiple venues. And as you know, there were many things happening simultaneously within the same venue. All this would not have been possible without the support of all these people from MANUU. The chairs, the chairpersons who readily agreed to be part of this conference, whether it was from University of Hyderabad or our own institution, they came for their sessions and endorsed this conference and endorsed the work of young scholars of this conference. A big thank you to all of them. And the entire staff of the Civil Service Coaching Academy where this conference went on, if not for you know, their untiring efforts, it would have been quite chaotic given that there were so many places and the people from you know, going into different rooms for various kinds of activities. I also want to thank two other institutions, Department of Culture, Government of Telangana, which came forward to sponsor the cultural program, and USFE, which sent the Fulbright scholars, Professor Deborah Logan and Rochelle Almeida. They were able to come to our conference because they were Fulbrighters located in various institutions concurrently. I also want to thank Orient Black Swan. You saw the exhibition out there, and I hope that many of you have made use of the exhibition and bought the books that you wanted. So their generous purse also helped us to organize some of the events of the seminar. I thank all the plenary speakers. There were four plenary speakers. I thank Ashish ji for the for being part of the valedictory and for giving a very interesting lectern last evening. I think since the time you landed in Hyderabad, you have been completely engaged. First with the music workshops, and then last evening's lectern, and today again the music workshop, and then the valedictory. I hope it has not been too tiring, or if it has been too tiring, it's only pleasant tiredness. I thank Professor Subburaidu again in this context for arranging the Tanpura yesterday. I think he had to take a lot of effort to arrange the instrument, and also the player Mayuri Lele for accompanying Ashishji in yesterday's performance. Every little cog in the wheel has, you know, come together to ensure that this conference has gone on, I would think, pretty smoothly. I don't know what your own perceptions are, how you will carry memories of this conference, but as an organizer, I would think, except for some glitches here and there, it has been fairly okay. I also want to thank the three artists whom we acknowledged in the morning, Nirmala, Preeti, and Priyanka, who conducted the art workshop. This was one of the things that we, one of the first things that we put together immediately after the academic part of the conference. Also all the artists, you saw those wonderful art exhibitions in the corridor. At least five or six artists came together to allow their works to be exhibited in the corridor. They're all very well-known artists. In fact, when they put their paintings, you know, in the room there, we were saying, it's 5 lakh worth or 10 lakh worth of paintings which they have allowed us to exhibit here in these corridors. So I thank the artists. I thank all the panelists. There were three panels. One of course was kind of in-house, but two other panels, the work image, word image, music panel, and the panel on translation and colonialism, which introduced the text. I also now thank the paper presenters. If you had not encouraged us by sending in your abstracts, it would not have materialized in this fashion. We were so happy to receive such good abstracts, and this really encourages us to think of many more events. As Dr. Asma was saying, the young scholars are taking directions, new directions in research, and we are ready to follow where you take us. Lastly, there are several volunteers who worked silently behind the screens, three of whom I have to name and acknowledge here, from not just after coming to the venue, but even before the conference began.